And we will request that we maintain absolute silence during the proceedings if we can. When our guest or the last entourage comes with our keynote speaker, you'll show appreciation in welcoming them, and then the program will start very soon. It's a pity we used to start these events with some kinds of songs. With the passage of time, we've lost our voices, I guess. This is the sign of our time. Ladies and gentlemen, if we can welcome the one and only Angela. You may be seated. Thank you, thank you. Without any waste of time, that moment we've been waiting for, that hour of anticipation is upon us, and that iconic legendary figure is in our midst. Some have read about her, some have written about her, but today we'll give her her own voice to speak to you. Let's take this time before we settle down for the 17th annual Steve Biko Memorial Lecture and ask our Vice Chancellor and the Principal of the University of South Africa to welcome us, to make us feel at home. Let's welcome him with another round of applause.
Dr. Figeni, our program director, thank you so much. And good evening to you. Mr. Saki Simelane, the chairperson of the UNISA Council, and Mrs. Simelane, your beloved half, all the members of council who are with us here tonight, Mrs. Makanya, our keynote speaker and a global icon of the struggles for social justice, Professor Angela Davis, our former first ladies and distinguished leaders in their own right, Mama Gracia Machel and Mama Zanele Mbeki, chairperson of the Steve Biko Foundation, and other members from the Steve Biko Foundation who are with us here tonight, Mr. Nkosinathi, as well as your beloved wife from the Steve Biko Foundation. But I just want to swiftly move on now to greet Ms. Y. Obenewa Aponsa, the Chief Executive Officer of the Steve Biko Foundation. And I want to pay tribute to all the members and extended members of the family of Ndate Biko, and I want to single out Mrs. Ntsiki Biko, who is the wife of the late Steve Biko. current and former cabinet ministers and deputy ministers who are with us here tonight. I also want to welcome Dr. Brigalia Bam, the chairperson of the Thabo Mbeki Foundation, who is also a former chairperson of the IEC. Professor Njabulo Ndebele, the chairperson of the Nelson Mandela Foundation, and Mr. Silo Hatang, the chief executive officer of the Nelson Mandela Foundation. Professor Pani Pijana and Mrs. Dimza Pijana. Prof. Pijana is the former principal and vice chancellor of this university. I mention this because he is the former comrade and contemporary of Steve Biko. Dr. Mampila Rampele, Your Excellencies, Ambassadors and High Commissioners present. I also want to welcome the representatives of the United Nations, to welcome the members of the royal families, members of the ecclesiastical community, colleagues from sister higher education institutions and research institutions, members of the business community, members and leaders of civil society, members of our National Student Representative Council, and all the other student formations, and leaders of all our political formations who are with us tonight, all invited dignitaries, members of the media, UNISA family and friends, together with the sponsors of tonight's event. Distinguished audience here present, as well as those viewing and listening to this event from various broadcast platforms in South Africa and around the world. Good evening to you all. Dumelang, Sanibonang, Molweni, Abshin, Bonsoir. On behalf of the University of South Africa and our partner, Steve Biko Foundation, it is with a sense of great joy that I welcome you to this historic 17th Steve Biko Annual Memorial Lecture this evening. We embrace you all in the spirit of Ubuntu. The much publicized build-up to this event that has gotten the country talking is an evidence of the significance of this public lecture that comes at a time when our country and the whole world is at the crossroads, facing immensely complex challenges and searching for answers. UNISA's partnership with the Steve Biko Foundation is creating intellectual space for difficult conversations that can yield answers and solutions to the challenges of our time, using and celebrating the legacy of a great thinker and struggle icon, Steve Biko. The combined and complementary strengths of our partnering institutions is already making waves in our society and beyond in an effort to shape futures in the service of humanity. Again, I would like to express our deep sense of gratitude to the Biko family and the Steve Biko Foundation for their generosity in allowing us to share and learn from the immortalized legacy of the late Steve Biko for the greater benefit of humanity. A special welcome to our keynote speaker tonight. We welcome you to your mother continent. We embrace you to South Africa. We are honored and blessed by your acceptance of our invitation to deliver this lecture tonight. I cannot think of a perfect keynote speaker than the iconic, towering intellectual and veteran of the struggle for social justice, then Professor Angela Davis. Rarely do you find a person who has been described using so many titles: a scholar, a Marxist, a radical feminist, a veteran of the struggle against racism around the world, and a distinguished scholar who is cited worldwide for her seminal works on a range of subjects. Indeed, in your presence tonight, we have a witness and a prominent leader who has helped to shape different epochs and scholarships of humanity's struggle for justice. You are a personification of a life lived for justice. Professor Davis has articulated and understood this when she said the following, and I quote, "I think the importance of doing activist work is precisely because it allows you to give back and to consider yourself not only as a single individual who may have achieved whatever, but to be a part of an ongoing historical movement," unquote. Professor Angela Davis, you come at a time when South Africa and the world are grappling with many challenges, ranging from the resurgence of racism, waves of new struggles for social justice, often led by the youth and students, gender-based violence and oppression, refugee crises, and struggle for scarce or diminishing resources. Whether it is Occupy Wall Street or Black Lives Matter in America, or it is a debate about languages and African hairstyles in South African schools, the struggles are universal for us to learn from each other. You come at the time when we are searching for leadership and ideas to confront these challenges. We therefore ask if a sage like you can help us understand the terms of our engagement, the principles of struggles for social justice within the current context, as well as creative spaces for intergenerational dialogues. In the last 120 years, there are many similarities and common challenges that America and Africa, or South Africa in particular, have shared and cross-pollinated on, and this engagement tonight is part of that long tradition which has advanced humanity's struggle for justice. The life of Steve Biko, who will have been 70 years this year, is a testimony of human agency that changed the course of history. Even more significant is the fact that Steve Biko performed most of his work and intellectual contribution in his youthful years before he died at the age of 31 years. This is a challenge to all of us, particularly to young activists, that they can emulate Steve Biko and many other struggle and intellectual giants who made immense contribution to justice and human advancement. At this historical moment of great challenges, Steve Biko's own words still ring true when he proclaimed that, quote, "The power of the movement lies in the fact that it can indeed change the habits of people. This change is not the result of force, but of dedication or moral persuasion," unquote. I invite all of us present here tonight and those following this lecture to open your minds and hearts and be treated into a vintage intellectual engagement by this towering intellectual giant and relentless gallant fighter for human justice. Again, we welcome you, we embrace you with open hearts, and we are ready to absorb and soak in your wisdom. The intellectual flame you light today shall be kept alive and will journey to all corners of our society and continent like an Olympic lamp for as long as our quest for a just society is not yet achieved. Let me invite all of us to participate and enjoy in this festival of ideas. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Professor Makanya. Indeed, we are inching towards that festival of ideas from an organic, grounded intellectual. Now let me call Ms. Obenewa Aponsa, who is the CEO of the Steve Biko Foundation. Let's put our hands together and welcome him.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you, Dr. Fakini. Over the years, Prof has taught me many things, and I think one of the most useful ones has been a specific phrase: all protocols have been observed. While a number of people have been welcomed, I would like to take a moment to acknowledge a few special guests who are here this evening. First and foremost, members of the Biko family, in particular Mrs. Nsiki Biko and Mr. Nkosinati Biko, founding trustees of the Steve Biko Foundation, as well as Mr. Millard Arnold, Professor Ben Huapa, and Mr. Ishmael Mkabela, who has chaired the foundation for a period of over a decade and led us with an extraordinary amount of patience, which we require, being a team of mainly young people, and also an extraordinary amount of grace. Thank you, Braish. I would also like to acknowledge Professor Njibulo Ndebele, who some might recall actually delivered the first Steve Biko Memorial Lecture in the year 2000 at the University of Cape Town. Thank you for joining us tonight, Prof. And of course, Vice Chancellor, it is an absolute delight to be back at UNISA tonight. And I think it's very significant that we are on your Pretoria campus commemorating the 39th anniversary of Bantu Stephen Biko's death in detention, because we are not far from Pretoria Maximum Security Prison where Biko died. Many will remember that there were those within the apartheid system who said they were left, and I quote, cold in the wake of Biko's death. But they did not know that Biko's words, that your manner of death can itself be a politicizing thing, would continue to ring true nearly four decades later. While political freedom has been won in the years since Biko's death, the struggle for economic, gender, and cultural equality is still being waged here in South Africa and abroad. Throughout the diaspora, the continent, and the country, a new generation of young people, inspired by the words and actions of Biko, Audre Lorde, Marcus Garvey, and many, many others, are addressing the challenges of the 21st century. And we are proud that in the audience tonight are students from Pretoria Girls High. Ladies, where are you this evening? There they are. In the past few weeks, they have not only shown us who they are, but from the response, I think they've reminded many of us of who we are. They've reminded us of our responsibility to be agents of change wherever we find ourselves. And ladies, for that, we thank you. For many of us, the images emanating from Pretoria Girls High recall the iconic Angela Davis with her fist raised in trademark Afro. Today, Professor Davis remains the reference point for many activists of her generation and those who have come after her. But not only did Professor Davis embody the style of the movement, she also embodied its substance. For me personally, as a young African woman, growing up in the United States, I cannot recall a time when I did not know the name Angela Davis. But it was only when I reached university that I really began to explore her ideas. One week into my four-year course, a young white man, a Russian immigrant who lived in my res, told me point blank, and this is a direct quote, "Everyone knows that black people are dangerous." I guess I hadn't gotten that memo, but encountering blatant, and in many more instances, subtle expressions of discrimination, I sought to better understand racism and how to challenge it. And in my quest, I found the work of Professor Davis and many of her peers. Needless to say that by my fourth year, I was also rocking my Afro, and it was pretty hot, if I do say so myself. But more importantly, I had a better sense of who I was, and I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that it is possible to change the status quo, not only as a black person, not only as a woman, but as a black woman. And my story is by no means unique. In the two short days since Professor Davis arrived in South Africa, I have been privileged to hear person after person speak about the impact that she had upon their lives, from those who took the pseudonym of Davis when going for military training, to inspiring people to political activism. Professor Davis has been an indelible impact upon individuals and communities worldwide. Long before the term intersectional became common, Professor Davis was woke. In fact, it was she who, through her intellectual labor on race, class, and gender, awakened many of us. 40 years after she came to international prominence, Davis's work remains exceedingly and almost painfully relevant. Painfully, because in the wake of the passage of the American Civil Rights Act and the winds of change that heralded the success of African liberation movements, It seemed as if revolution that would entrench racial equality was imminent. Yet still today, this is not the case. From Ferguson to Freetown to Free State, we must continually assert that Black lives matter. If anything, with the attainment of each landmark act, the independence of an African state, or the end of apartheid, it was as if the other fault lines within our societies emerged, whether they were fault lines based on race, class, gender, or sexual orientation. Indeed, these fissures do not only appear within society, but within the very organizations and movements meant to address them, whether they be feminist, student, or political. While this is not a new phenomenon, it is one that must be interrogated. And to be clear, the call for an intersectional, multidimensional approach is not a nice to do or a good to have. It is imperative. In the words of Martin Luther King Jr., injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. In short, if our struggles for equality are to truly bring about justice, they cannot be about just us. This paradox of which struggle will be at the forefront of a society's agenda is not a new one. It was one articulated by members of the Black Consciousness Movement when they spoke, as Black women, of having to choose between prioritizing racial or gender justice. Members of the Black Panther Party, whose ethos was in some ways similar to that of the BCM, also spoke of the patriarchy within their movement and the struggle to overcome it. It was, in fact, in 1966, 50 years ago, that the Black Panther Party was formed. So again, it is a timely opportunity to reflect on the life and legacy of Steve Biko, his ideas and those of similar international movements. In honestly assessing what has gone before, and in highlighting some of the unfinished business of earlier movements, the intention is not to undermine the significant contributions that were made or to minimize their impact. Rather, it's about learning, about better understanding where we have been so we are fully able to understand ourselves, and more importantly, understand the possibilities of who we can become. In the words of Biko, attention has to be paid to our history if we want to aid each other in our coming into consciousness. Which is why we are so very honored that Professor Davis accepted our invitation. An activist for over four decades, Davis is someone Cornel West has described as one of the few great long-distance intellectual freedom fighters in the world. She became known to the world in large part through the organizing of the Black Panther Party, among others, who ensured that Free Angela was the international rallying cry in the wake of her incarceration in 1970. The third woman in US history to be on the FBI's most wanted list, Professor Davis's alleged crimes were murder, kidnapping, and conspiracy. A conviction for any one of these charges could have meant death. Professor Davis herself has noted that although many thought she was innocent, few believed it was possible that she would be acquitted. Her freedom was due in large part to international solidarity. Professor Davis further indicated that if she is an icon representing anything, her freedom represents our collective power. It represents our ability to bring about change when we act together. This is why we gather tonight, physically and virtually, to reflect on this collective power. To remind ourselves, whether or not we consider ourselves to be activists in the traditional sense, that we each have a role to play. In the words of Biko, history works through people, and we have availed ourselves to history to work through us. This idea is what drives us at the Steve Biko Foundation, the idea that we are each history makers in our own lives, our communities, and ultimately, the life of humanity. Our hope is that through our work at the Steve Biko Foundation and our gathering tonight, that we would be empowered to make the contribution Biko articulated when he wrote, "We believe that in the long run, the special contribution to the world by Africa will be in this field of human relationship. The great powers of the world may have done wonders in giving the world an industrial and military look, but the great gift still has to come from Africa, giving the world a more human face." Thank you.
Wow. Another round of applause. Thank you. Okay, our sound engineers must make sure that we project the sound. I'm told we are not alone. This is being broadcasted live by SABC Channel 44, by eNCA, by SAFM, by Ubuntu Radio throughout the continent and the world, by UNISA Radio, and it is being web streamed to the Steve Biko Foundation Center in King Williamstown, in places like Grahamstown, Cape Town, Brazil, Liverpool in the UK. So many of us will be transformed. At this moment, without any waste of time, I will be calling on the one who has come to disturb and provoke life. I will be calling on the one who has been called to agitate our imagination.
Inkosi masithambe isicaka sivumile bantu bakuthi. Iwu zemke inkomo magolandini. Lakwala kyahlekwa. Lokoti kyalilwa. Umanyano ngemandla. Nzayiqaqanisa intetha nganye into zakuthi. Ndizogawulwa ndwarhuqa. Injoli sezime ngam. Unogqaza wejiwe. Maningi nemxolweni sizwe. Indaba zalibasa umakude eqhwesha. Welcome home, mama. Welcome home, princess. This is home, mama. Africa is home. Welcome to the motherland. Uthi mama ke thetha. I am no longer accepting the things I cannot change. I am changing the things I cannot change. Igama lamakhosikazi. Malibongwe. Phungu phungu baphi no mama. Igama lamakhosikazi. Malibongwe. Dela kufa inhliziyo yomelele ngusozi isitulo sodaka qhawekazi kosazana makiwe sizwe igama lamakhosikazi malibongwe ayisukani majo Kaukangela buhle besizwe. Namhlanje sithi mama nali lizwe lakho wenu. Namhlanje sithi makudeda umnyama kuvela ukukhanya. Kasikhumbula kaloku umfoka Biko. Mama. Siyabulela. Kubo bonke umama namhlanje sithi mazane thole nangomso ningadinwa. Hliziyo ethambo kwenqata lehagu. Vula ngathuthumiyo kanyambelu lamileyo kwekwaze kanyuna phakade langalo kulungisa zasukisa suka indlela zembokisa mila ntanyeni zasukisa suka impundu zamila madangeni kwentuku entathu sizwe sobe sikhumbula umfoka Biko namhlanje masithole ngazulenye sithi long live Steve Biko long live
Amen.
Long live the spirit of faith consciousness, long live!
Long live!
Hayi bantu baseMzantsi Afrika niyazithanda indaba. Dagam! Yo!
Thank you. Thank you. I'm now going to present to you a person who graduated from the University of Life in the Faculty of Hard Knocks. The one who needs no introduction, I present to you Professor Angela Davis.
It seems that I should visit South Africa more frequently. Let me tell you what a great honor it is to have been invited to deliver the Steve Biko Memorial Lecture this year. And of course, I'd like to thank the Vice Chancellor, Professor Makanya, Professor Fakenya, and Obenwa Amponsa, the CEO of the Steve Biko Foundation, for inviting me. I have been asked to speak about the legacy of Steve Biko, about my own experiences as an activist, and about contemporary struggles for justice. So let me begin by honoring the legacy of a man who immersed himself in struggle, who worked collaboratively to radically transform lives and institutions, a man whose life and work have inspired so many people in South Africa, in the United States, and throughout the world. I am especially happy that I had the opportunity to meet and converse with Steve Biko's wife, Mrs. Ntsiki Biko, and with his son, Nkosinathi Biko, along with a number of people involved in the foundation. Let me say that I'm extremely honored to be in the presence of the two first ladies of South Africa. Thank you so much for attending. And I've had the opportunity during the 2 days that I've been here, less than 2 days, to meet with a number of people, activists representing several generations, people involved in the Steven Biko Foundation. And today I had a very brief but very inspiring visit to the Mandela Archives at the Mandela Foundation. I chose the topic, legacies and unfinished activisms, because I think it captures some of the dilemmas of the contemporary moment. We are called upon to celebrate those whose dreams and whose activisms made it possible for us to inhabit this present. And as dissatisfied as we may be, and in fact, we should be with the present, this is a present that was ushered into being by the transformative impact of past revolutionary struggles. The disjuncture between what we once imagined as a future of freedom and justice, and the present, whose unfreedoms and injustices have become as apparent to young people as those of the past were to us, this disjuncture produces new dynamics of struggle. I thus constantly remind myself that the revolution we were fighting for at some point began to recede to the background and became the increasingly unacknowledged backdrop of the victories we did win. The revolution we wanted was not the revolution we helped to produce. So when I reflect on the current moment, when I reflect on the United States, I ask myself, what might we have done differently had we known that the election of the first black president would be followed by the farcical election campaign we are currently experiencing? I asked myself whether a greater insistence on the hidden structural dimensions of racism, the economic, cultural, and generally institutionalized forms of racism, which fostered the continued development of a huge psychic reservoir of racism, whether such an insistence might have made a difference, the kind of difference that might have prevented the Trump campaign, and I will mention his name only once, that might have prevented the Trump campaign, that's twice, from trafficking with the white rage, from trafficking with the white rage that is a product of the growing inequalities generated by global capitalism. These white people who are suffering, who know that their children will be worse off than they are led to attribute their misfortunes to the rise of people of color. And so the open appeal to racism comes in the form of the representation of Mexican undocumented workers as rapists and criminals, and the equation of Islam with terrorism. The subtext, of course, with the open attack on President Obama is that black people and other people of color have usurped the places and privileges which rightfully belong to white people. From a very early period of my activism, South Africa was our primary beacon of hope. From my earliest years as an activist, I eagerly read Sechaba and the African Communists. My comrades and I embraced the leaders of the ANC and the leaders of the South African Communist Party as our leaders. Solidarity with the anti-apartheid struggle infused our movements against racism, our movements for social justice, with a vast reservoir of energy. And the release of Mandela in 1990, the victorious election in 1994, brought collective euphoria to black communities and anti-racist struggles everywhere. Here, at last, was the path to freedom. I would not have been able to imagine then that two decades after the defeat of apartheid, we would be confronted with militaristic responses to people's protests. But before we immerse ourselves in the chaos of the current moment, let us visit the source of our legacies. This evening, we are memorializing Steve Biko. Steve Biko offered us a politics of blackness that released it from the constraints of inferiority and let us know that black people could collectively embody humanity and the foundational impulse toward freedom. Blackness was to be reimagined and reconstructed in the very process of collective struggle. As Mandela said of Steve Biko living, he was the spark that lit a veld fire across South Africa. His message to the youth and students was simple and clear. Black is beautiful. Be proud of your blackness. And with that, Mandela continues, he inspired our youth to shed themselves of the sense of inferiority they were born into as a result of more than 300 years of white rule. Black was not only proclaimed to be beautiful, black would become the sign of a trajectory toward human emancipation. In Biko's own words, it becomes more necessary to see the truth as it is if you realize that the only vehicle for change are those who have lost their personality. The first step is to make the black man come to himself, to pump life into his empty shell, to infuse him with pride and dignity, to remind him of his complicity in the crime of allowing himself to be misused and therefore letting evil reign supreme in the country of his birth. This was a stirring, powerful statement. But I must also point out here that the political discourse of the time had the effect of foreclosing the participation and the acknowledged conscientization of those who did not fall under the sign of the male gender. And as we know, some of the most passionate activists in the student movement of that period were women. And we know that the first major protests, so to speak, the mother of all protests, had been the Women's March to Pretoria on August 9th, 1956. And so I have kept in my mind the image of that monumental gathering. Lillian Ngoyi, Helen Joseph, Albertina Sisulu, Fatima Mayer, Florence Mofoso, Ruth Mompati, Sophie Williams de Breen, and all of the 20,000 women staging a silent protest here in Pretoria in front of union buildings. Now you have touched the women. You have struck a rock. You have dislodged a boulder. You will be crushed. Women have always been at the heart of anti-racist and progressive activism. We thus have to give ourselves permission to honor the women activists as we celebrate the legacies of the men who have come to represent the struggles of the past. And those men who most deserve to be celebrated, men like W.E.B. Du Bois, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X in the United States. In South Africa, men like Nelson Mandela, Chris Hani, and of course, Steve Biko. As influenced as they may have all been by ideologies of patriarchy, of heteropatriarchy, their work helped to create a discursive arena for the development of black feminist consciousness. They were also aware that their leadership was precisely enabled by those with whom they struggled, and not only the men, but the women as well. We are thankful, profoundly thankful for these legacies, but we do not receive them uncritically. Our understandings of the past are very much determined by our positions in the present and by how we imagine the future. From the perspective of the present, we can apprehend what was hidden behind the restrictive discourses of the past. Steve Biko died so that we would be able to develop these perspectives today. And we understand today some of the silences, some of the erasures, some of the foreclosures of those past struggles. We have also learned important lessons from the arrests Biko endured, from his imprisonment, from the torture, and from the long struggle to reveal the true circumstances of his death. Biko organized students. Students have always been at the forefront of radical change. An essential dimension of the learning process is critical thinking, learning how to question things as they are, learning how to imagine the possibility of something different is the very essence of education. Facts are easily attainable, especially today. People who have access to the internet have access to infinite libraries of factual information. But what do we do with that information? Steve Biko and his comrades led vast numbers of students to raise questions about apartheid and to imagine a different world, even as they clashed with the world as it was. Knowledge is useless unless it assists us to question habits, social practices, institutions, ideologies, the state. This questioning cannot end, even when victories are won. Even when victories are won. Students are now recognizing that the legacies of past struggles are not static. If these legacies mean anything at all, they are mandates to develop new strategies, new technologies of struggle. And these legacies, when they are taken up by new generations, reveal unfulfilled promises of the past, and therefore give rise to new activisms. As an activist of Steve Biko's generation, I have to constantly remind myself that the struggles of our contemporary times should be thought of as productive contradictions, because they constitute a rupture with past struggles, but at the same time, they reside on a continuum with those struggles, and they have been enabled by activisms of the past. They are unfinished activisms. Activisms enabled by the Montgomery bus boycott in 1955, thank you. by Mkonto We Siswe. This is the genealogy young activists share across oceans. The young activists of today stand on our shoulders. And precisely because they stand on our shoulders, they see something of what we have seen, but they also see and understand a great deal more. They are beginning to address unresolved questions and some of the erasures and foreclosures about which I spoke earlier. They stand on our shoulders, but we do not provide a steady foundation. Precisely because our questions were questions of a different era. Our critiques were expressed in the inadequate discourses of the past. And the young activists want to reveal the erasures. They want to question what we did not have the full capacity to question in our time. Therefore, they sway, they teeter-totter, they falter, they make terrible mistakes, just as we did at their age. When we stood on the shoulders of those who came before us, but just as we learn from our mistakes, they must be allowed to learn from theirs. They must be allowed to learn from theirs, even when it appears that they are simply repeating our mistakes. One of the truly exciting dimensions about the activisms, both here in South Africa and in the Black Lives Matter movement in the US, is that they are being led by women. I had the honor of meeting Nopendulo Mikachwa, am I pronouncing your name correctly? Who is the current president of the Student Representative Council at WITS, and Shayera Kala, who is the past president. And under their leadership, the contestation of the fee hikes, fees must fall, began to resonate across the country and around the world. There's some who've said that the student demands are unrealistic, especially when students begin to call for free education. But the demand for free education is only realistic because we continue to live with the mandates of capitalism. Compelled to think about education as a commodity. And especially in the aftermath of the global Occupy movement, the thoroughgoing commodification of education under the dictates of capital is increasingly viewed by progressive activists as an obscenity. This is not the way things should be. Freedom should mean, in the very first place, the freedom of education, the freedom to learn. And the prerequisite for enjoying freedom of education should not be the capacity to pay. It should not be the capacity to pay. If students are calling for free education, they are reminding us how retrograde our social priorities have become. The demand for free education reminds us of the world we should be inhabiting. It reminds us of the legacies that have produced impulses toward the future. When they move from no fee hikes to free education, They remind us of the revolution we need to be fighting today. The three young women in the US who first produced the hashtag Black Lives Matter, Alicia Garza, Patrice Cullors, and Opal Tometi, who first produced the hashtag Black Lives Matter in the aftermath of the vigilante racist killing of Trayvon Martin. And then went on to create the network Black Lives Matter. As the Ferguson protest erupted 2 years ago, these young women are collectively striving to remind us of the revolution we need as they try to develop strategies for struggle today. There's been an uneasy relationship with the veterans of the movement that came before them. The uneasiness emanates from the fact that veterans often take themselves and their knowledges too seriously. Sometimes we assume that our questions and the tentative answers we provided to those questions deserve to be accorded a permanence that silences future questions and answers. Sometimes we look for leadership in the familiar guys, the charismatic male leader, who in the US historically has emerged from church communities or religious circles. And when we cannot find that form of leadership, we say their movement has no leaders. But they answer back, our movement is full of leaders. We are not a leaderless movement, we are a leaderful movement. And the Black Lives Matter movement seeks to build new forms of leadership, feminist leadership. Leadership, whether of women or men, queer, trans, or straight. Leadership that is collective. Leadership that is collective, inclusive, and democratic. And so perhaps we now need the leadership of those who have been historically barred from leadership positions, those who have been silenced. Perhaps we need leadership that will assist us to develop new vocabularies, vocabularies that encourage inclusiveness and interconnectedness, vocabularies that recognize interdependences, intersectionalities, and internationalisms of our struggle. In other words, vocabularies that highlight the feminist dimensions of all of our social justice struggles. We have learned how our languages and our institutions, including our prisons, participate in the reproduction of ideologies of gender that violently exclude those who cannot find themselves within binary gender structures. Trans women of color have brought new analyses of our institutions, especially institutions of punishment, which have deepened our understanding of the importance of abolitionist approaches. Prison abolition, which calls for the abolition of imprisonment as the dominant mode of punishment, and the abolition of policing as we know it, must also involve the abolition of racism and the abolition of gender policing and a constant critique of heteropatriarchy. We have learned about the symbiotic interconnectedness of state violence and intimate violence. We now perceive an economy of violence in which the symbiotic relationship of different modes of violence, state violence, institutional violence, intimate violence, thrives on excess violence directed at certain communities, for example, trans communities of color. Revealing these reservoirs of violence and openly challenging them helps to diminish the overall economy of gender violence. The message of the Black Lives Movement is that Black lives are not abstract and fungible lives that can be subject to repression under the sign of the universal equality of human beings. The Black Lives Movement challenges what we might call the tyranny of the universal. And I say that there's something very important and very powerful that Black lives offer. Histories and temporalities and languages and aesthetics and possibilities of freedom. Possibilities of freedom. This tyranny of the universal was first challenged, I believe, in political social action by the Haitian Revolution. If we examine struggles against slavery everywhere, we know that in every important movement there were resonances of the Haitian Revolution. The insistence by women and men who came to call themselves Haitian that to be human is to collectively struggle to be free. There is no such thing as freedom for a single individual. We know that freedom as it has been conceived under bourgeois democracies has always been a limited freedom, a freedom accorded to racial, class, and gender elites, a freedom that acquires its value precisely because of its powers of exclusion. There is a direct line from Haiti as the world's first anti-racial democracy, thus the world's first true democracy. There's a direct line from that revolution to the Black Lives Matter movement today. The insistence on the particularity of the Black predicament is precisely that which is capable of yielding a robust universality. Because for most of our history, the very category human has not embraced Black people. Its abstractness has been colored white and gendered male. But there are those who think that by removing race from the equation, instead of saying Black lives matter, by saying all lives matter, we somehow magically transcend race. But of course, if all lives mattered, we would not need to emphatically proclaim that Black lives matter. And if you look at the Black Lives Matter website, you will see Black women matter, Black girls matter, Black gay lives matter, Black bi lives matter, Black boys matter, Black queer lives matter, Black men matter, Black lesbians matter, Black trans lives matter, Black immigrants matter, Black incarcerated lives matter, Black differently abled bodies matter. Therefore, to say that Black Lives Matter is to say that Latino and Asian American and Native American and Muslim and poor and working class white people's lives matter. It is to say all lives matter. And so, as it turns out, the very particularity of the claim Black Lives Matter leads us toward a richer, more inclusive, less hierarchical universal. It leads us not toward narrow, exclusive nationalism, but rather towards expansive, capacious internationalisms. These internationalisms are symbolized by the strong ties that have been developed between Palestine solidarity and Black Lives Matter. Indeed, South African movements supporting the BDS, the Boycott, Divestment, and Solidarity Campaign, have given leadership to people all over the world. A particularly strong affinity between Palestinian struggles and Black Lives Matter activists emerged when activists on the ground in Palestine 2 years ago became the very first to offer solidarity and advice to the Ferguson protesters through social media. Since Palestinians recognize that the canisters being thrown by the police in Ferguson were manufactured by the same company as the tear gas canisters used by Israeli police and military in Palestine, they tweeted out advice to their sisters and brothers in this small town in Missouri, in Ferguson, Missouri, as to how to deal with the militarized police who were attacking them. The globalism of police militarization was challenged by the globalism of resistance. History tends to elude us in the very process of its becoming. We always seem to falter when it comes to recognizing the present as history. Clarity only seems to emerge when we can no longer affect the passage of historical time. Although we can never predict definitive outcomes when we are entangled in abundant and the complex circumstances of the present, and Stuart Hall pointed out that there are never any guarantees for our struggle. Nonetheless, it is our collective duty to imagine possible futures. When Muhammad Ali refused to be inducted into the military in 1967, we could not know at the time that this would become an iconic historical moment, as was the raising of the fist by Tommy Smith and John Carlos at the Mexico Olympics in 1968. Perhaps Colin Kaepernick's refusal to stand during the singing of our militaristic national anthem that is replete with aural images of bombs bursting in air. Perhaps this will become another such moment. Or perhaps the actions by the girls at Pretoria High School, and we've seen many images of Zuleika Patel. This moment may very well be the historical conjuncture we have been waiting for. We cannot really know, but we cannot let it pass without asserting our collective agency in order to begin to purge our societies of racisms, including Islamophobia and settler colonialism, as well as anti-Semitism, sexism, homophobia, ableism, assaults against immigrants and refugees, and the unremitting capitalist assault on our environment and on our food sources and on the sentient beings who endure pain and torture as they are transformed into food for profit, food that generates disease in humans whose poverty compels them to rely on McDonald's and KFC for nourishment. Even though there are never guarantees that we will reach the futures we dream, we cannot stop dreaming. We cannot stop dreaming, and we cannot stop struggling. Not even if, and I say when, we begin to see the crumbling of capitalism. There will always be vibrant legacies. There will always be unfulfilled promises. There will always be unfinished activisms. Thank you very much.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. We may be seated. We've just been treated into what I would call a manifesto of the current generation of struggles. Like a vintage wine, I've just noticed that the flame in the belly of this revolutionary has not lost any of its energy over the decades. And we as men have just been reminded that it is not the Women's Month only where the lives of women matter. This is the most compelling thesis about gender justice and about the fact that you will not exercise violence between now and that time of the 16 days of violence against women in December. Let it be an everyday thing. And lastly, I think she was reminding us that this is the passing of the torch to the next generation in our quest for justice. And now, without any waste of time, I will be asking our Vice Chancellor and Principal, together with the CEO of the Steve Biko Foundation of Benewa, and indeed, as part of the passing of that torch to the next generation, we'll ask Zuleika Patel from Pretoria Girls High to come forward. If she can come forward, please. We can allow Pretoria Girls High. There is a token of appreciation that we're going to give to our keynote speaker, our guest. Thank you. Now you've seen the young generation that is beginning to write the pages of history, standing side by side by a what I call the rock of ages, a seasoned veteran, a revolutionary, Angela Davis. Let's give them a round of applause. Thank you, thank you. Now you will be seated. I'll just be making a few announcements. At this moment, we will remain seated as our proceedings are drawing to a close, as our dignitaries will be moving and be led to Khorong, but we will still have the accredited media to have formal interview sessions, question and answer sessions with our keynote speaker. Some light refreshments will be served in the foyer. And I can assure you that is the same menu as it is in different venues. Because we have an egalitarian approach to serving. Again, you will remain seated as our guest speaker, the VC, the CEO, Lee. Whilst they leave, you can continue with the singing. Igama lamakhosikazi.